Hi, this is John. I'm the designer of Houses of the Blooded, and this is the first episode of a kind of design blog thing that I'm going to be doing, putting up every Friday. So, in this first episode, I'd like to talk a little bit about different interpretations of the Venn, and give you a few options for how your game may go based on how those interpretations interpret. So, here we go. Let's get started. So the first setting is the one that I'm actually playing in on Friday nights. It was suggested by Ro Watts, who gets mentioned in the credits of the book. And Ro suggested, when I said I wanted to play the game and offered the opportunity for someone to run it, Ro said that what she wanted to do was to do a Polynesian interpretation of the Venn. And what that meant was a lot of bare feet, a lot of very colorful robes, a lot of exotic flowers and birds and jungles and islands, of course. But not only that, by suggesting that, it also gave us a lot of ideas for how the Venn wore weapons, because one of the elements of the game is that is whether you're wearing a sword or not. In Venn culture, if you're wearing a sword, it means I can use this, and you can challenge and be challenged to a duel. And if you're not wearing a sword, then you can't be challenged to a duel, and you can't challenge other people to duels, but consequently you can't take offense to anything. So what Ro suggested was that most of the Venn walked around wearing wooden swords as symbols of their status, saying, this is my sword, I'm wearing one, and don't screw around with me. And if it came down to a duel, then people would use the wooden swords to settle matters of honor that were trivial. Or, you know, no matter of honor is trivial, but that weren't deadly. But then they would go home, and if it was a serious issue, then they would go home and get the metal swords. This is a real issue. And so the difference between whether you're wearing wood and metal became another interpretive element of the game, in that if you're wearing wood, it means I'm very difficult to offend, and if you're wearing metal, then it means don't screw with me today. So, again, just changing that element of making the islands very volcanic, having a lot of rock, having a lot of wooden buildings, all that, gave the Venn a very distinct flavor, a very distinct style that set it apart from the kind of style that I had in my head when I first wrote the game. And at first I thought about it and I said, I can't quite grasp that, but mainly it's because I didn't know anything about Islander culture. And then when I started looking at it, I went, that's absolutely perfect. So just taking the Venn and putting them down in that part of the world, in the Polynesian world, really changed what the game is like. Something that someone else is doing on the forums is they're talking about running a game that has a post-apocalyptic feel in a very real sense of the word. They want to play the Venn as the survivors of an end-of-the-world scenario involving the Aztecs or the Incans. So, again, we have jungles, and we have the huge ancient pyramids of a culture long dead, and the Venn are the survivors of that culture. So with this setting, again, you get more of the a very different kind of setting. You get South America with the big giant honking spiders, which really fit the whole idea of the Venn enemy, the Venn seeing the world as a living enemy trying to kill them. And you get that the totemic animals then also take on a completely different kind of flavor, because a jaguar can replace the wolf, and you can pick different animals that are keen in that culture and just mix them up and replace them. And again, just setting it in that setting, in a South American setting, with blood for the blood god and all the blood sacrifice and all of that, blood to make the sun come up in the morning, you get a very different view of how the Venn might have been. Another suggestion that Rowe made was, another brilliant one, was creating a setting that would put the issue of a really ugly issue of Venn culture right at the forefront. And that is the social structure of the Venn, the relationship between the blooded and the unblooded. The unblooded, the Venn word for them is dirt. That's what they are. They're something you walk on. They're something you kick. And the greeting that the unblooded have for the nobility is translates to, please don't kill me. And while this is an important element of the Venn culture, a lot of times it can get pushed to the side or even just completely ignored. But the setting that Rowe suggested puts it right up in the forefront, especially if you were born or live in North America. And that was putting Venn culture in the 18th century American South, the very end of the 18th century, the beginning of the 19th century, where you have plantation houses instead of castles, and you still have the concept of gentry, you still have the concept of American nobility, and there's honor, and there's all that kind of stuff, and right there in your face, so you can't ignore it, is, let's not mince words, slavery. The blooded and the unblooded, and their relationship pushed right up to the front by placing the Venn in the American South. Now, I wish I had thought of that, but I didn't, so I'm going to put it here and make myself look smart. First, someone made the suggestion of running Legend of the Five Rings or a Japanese setting with the House of the Blooded Rules, and I think that's just pretty cool. It also gives houses like the Blooded of the Fox a definitely different connotation. The fox has one kind of character in Western culture and has another kind of character in cultures like the Japanese. So all of those totemic animals take on different meanings and probably take on different virtues as well. But assigning those characteristics to the different houses in a Japanese setting would definitely be interesting. And then finally, someone mentioned running either Dune or Amber with the Houses of the Blooded Rules. And I'm a big fan of Dune, so I think that's absolutely perfect. Giving each of the houses a virtue, giving each of the houses a weakness, all that kind of stuff, that just rocks. And it also presents an opportunity to put the Venn in a far future space opera setting as opposed to a fantasy opera setting. So just change all your regions to planets and change all your provinces to systems and... But keep the idea of swords, because space opera is about flying around in ships and sword fights, so there you go. Oh, and Amber. So here's what you do for Amber, okay? A little more bonus. Here's what you do for Amber. Like enemy gods, your stats are the Amberites, okay? So you don't have strength and cunning and all that. Instead, you have Corwin and Benedict and Blaze and all that. Figure out what each of those characters, because each of those characters is iconic. So figure out what each of those characters is and assign them as virtues on your sheet. And, you know, you can even do a bid if you want, the typical Amber bid. And so you have a Corwin of 3, which would translate to endurance, and a Benedict of 4, which would translate to prowess and all of that. And if the risk is something that Benedict or Corwin or Blaze or Fiona would be good at, then you roll that many dice. And there you go. My gift to you, my Amber-loving brothers. So that's it for this week. Next week I'm going to have a preview of the Slumming book, which is coming along splendidly. I'll give you guys some things to playtest with, some new mechanics. And in the meantime, Blood and Roses for you.